Spirit, and we're ready to receive everything he has tonight. Right, family? Let's just welcome him. I know he came in us and with us, but let's just make sure the Holy Spirit knows he is welcome to have his way tonight. Holy Spirit, we welcome you tonight. Father, we love you so much. We receive your love as we worship you. Fill us again and again and again with your divine love. Make us love, Father. Make us just like Jesus. Spirit, soul, and body. That is our desire, to become conformed to the image of Christ. And Father, your word tells us that as we behold you, we are changed, we are transformed, and that's what we desire, to be changed in your presence, to undergo that metamorphosis as we worship you, Lord. May you be glorified and magnified tonight. Change your people. Meet them right where they're at. Let answers come from on high and help. In Jesus' name, we give you all the glory. Hallelujah. You can come up here, do whatever you want to worship King Jesus. Amen.
The blind will see, through you the mute will sing, through you the dead will rise, through you our hearts will praise, through you the darkness flees, through you my heart screams, I am free, I am free, I am free to run. I am free today.
I am free
today. I am free to live for you.
I am free to live
for you.
I am free.
The battle won. Through you I'm not afraid. Through you the price is paid. Through you there's victory. Because of you my heart screams, I am free.
I am free to run. I am free.
Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
You provide the fire. Provide the sacrifice. You provide the spirit and I will open up inside. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God.
Fill me up, God. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. Hearing your love, hearing your love. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. Hearing your love, hearing your love. We want only your love, God. Only your love, God. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. Hearing your love, hearing your love. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. Hearing your love, hearing your love. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. Yes, I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. Yes, I want more of you, God. Only more of you. Only more of you, God. More of you. Only more of you. Only more of your spirit, more of your love, more of your spirit. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. Won't you pour it out? There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. Won't you pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. Won't you pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. There's no end to your love. Won't you pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. Pour out your love. Pour out your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. Yes, I want more of you, God. More of you, God. With every part of me, I reach for you. I reach for you, Lord. With every part of me, I reach for you. I reach for you, Lord. For more of your love. I reach for you. I reach for you. With every part of me, I reach for you. I reach for you. I reach for you. With every part of me.
Thank you.
listen close, I can hear your still small voice whispering, you're always here with me, and your love never fails. Your voice is guiding me, and your kingdom lives with me. No matter what it seems, Lord, you are right here with me. No matter what may rise against, your word says I am complete. Lord, you are right here in me. You are holy, full of power. You are worthy, Lord. I will walk in your glory. Now the blind will see that there's no other name. left but you. Take us over. Let your glory fall.
Rain down your glory.
Take us over.
Raining down
glory. Let your glory fall.
Let it rain.
Take us over. To love like you do. Wanna look like our Father. So teach us to love as you do. You wanna look like you. Teach us to love like you do. We wanna look like you do. So show us what we mean to. Show us what the world and every heart and every soul means to you. We want to look like you do. Look like
you. Holy Spirit, transform us. Transform us. Make us so mad.
Body function just like you called us to.
And you we live, and you we move, and you we have a being. And you, it's in you, Jesus.
It's only in you.
I just see the Lord. We're like clay on the potter's wheel. In these times of intimacy, He's pouring oil on us. He's pouring water on us. And He's taking us in His hands. And He's potting us. We're letting love pot us. Love mold us. Love make us. Love transform us. Lord, we thank You. We yield to that process right now, Lord. We thank You, Lord. We're in Your hands. We're being fashioned by You. You've already got something in mind. And we yield to Your process, Your transformation. We yield even to the fire, because after the clay is fashioned, it has to be put in the kiln, and it has to be baked at high levels of heat so that it comes out perfect. We even yield to the fire. We yield to the fire. Tell Him, I yield to Your fire. I yield to Your fire, Lord. Glory to God. Refining fire. Refining fire. Purifying fire. Thank You, Lord. Polishing. I just see the Lord. It's like He's got a piece of fine silver in His hand. And He's just taking the cloth and He's just polishing it till it shines. He's just polishing us, church. Refining us. Polishing us. Hallelujah. And I'm reminded of a story that Mark Hankins tells about microwave popcorn. He said he puts the popcorn in the microwave. You've done it yourself. You put the popcorn in the microwave and you turn on the microwave. 30 seconds goes by, nothing happens. A minute goes by. No change whatsoever. If you were just looking with your senses, you would think nothing was happening whatsoever. 2 minutes go by, no change at all. About 2.5 minutes into the process, there's a pop. Pretty soon there's another pop. And then there's a pop, pop. And then there's a pop, pop, pop. And then pretty soon, right at the end of the process, about 3.5 minutes in, 3 minutes and 15 seconds, it's pop, 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 pop. Popping as fast as you can imagine that that popcorn starts popping. What has happened? The heat, the fire has built up. And right now what he's doing, because we're having these, seems like the Lord is really pouring out his spirit in worship. Things are happening. Things you can't see with your natural eye are happening. Things are popping in the spirit realm. Things you've been believing. And see, if you can be believing, and this is one thing the Holy Spirit was sharing with me, you can be perfectly executing the mechanics of faith. You can have the promise of God. You can believe you receive the promise. You can call those things which be not as though they were. But if your microwave's on defrost, nothing's happening. And right now what God is doing during these times of worship in his presence is he's turning things. Some of you haven't been on high. He's turning you up on high so that you see the manifestation of what you've been believing for, the goodness of God in the land of the living. The Bible says hope deferred makes the heart grow sick, but when the desire comes, it is a tree of life. When you see the goodness of God manifest in your life, praise God, there is a joy. There is a joy that is released. Matter of fact, he said, ask and you shall receive. Why? That your joy may be full. He wants you to receive what he has for you. Why? So your joy will not be halfway full, but your joy will be completely full. Completely full of joy. That's a good witness, isn't it? That's good advertising for the Good Shepherd. Why do you have such a big smile plastered on your face all the time? Well, I serve a good God. I serve a good shepherd, and he's taken really, really good care of me. Is he taking good care of you? Has he saved you? Has he healed you? Has he delivered you? Glory to God. I'll tell you, if all that happened to you is you missed the lake of fire, as if that's all, if that's all that happened, if that's all you ever experienced of the goodness of God, which trust me, it's not, is you missed the lake of fire, that would be enough to dance and shout and run for all eternity. All eternity. Glory to God. Your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. You've been raised up together. You've been seated in Christ Jesus, in the anointed Jesus, in his anointing. Take your place of authority. Exercise your authority. Know that you have the authority. Don't put up with the enemy working in your life, in your family's life, in your kids' life. But take your authority in Christ Jesus and trample every adversary. Amen? People, by the way, it's not people you trample. It's demons and evil spirits. Amen? We don't wrestle with flesh and blood. And glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. How many of you got something tonight during worship? Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we just worship you. We thank you. We give you praise. We magnify your holy name. We thank you, Lord, for what's being poured out. We yield to it. We receive it with thanksgiving. We say, have your own way, Lord. Have your way. You're the head of the church. We love your presence, Father. We love your presence. We thank you that in your presence is fullness of joy. In your presence is creative power, miracles. Everything that we have need of is in your presence. And we're in the presence of El Elyon, the Most High God, whose power no foe can withstand. And I thank you, Lord, that power works in us mightily. Your word says the power is to us word who believe. And your word says you're able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And what causes the power to work in us? It's yielding to that power, and it's believing. Thank you, Lord. We believe your word. Be it unto us according to your word. Lord, we thank you that we are the head and not the tail. We are above only and not beneath. Though our enemies come against us one way, they shall be smitten before our face and flee before us seven ways. Lord, you are opening unto us heaven's treasuries, the heavens that give the rain in its season, to bless all the work of our hand. We shall lend to many nations, and we shall not borrow. Lord, we're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. We're redeemed from the curse of the law, and we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Jesus has made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. And we reign and rule in life by one Jesus Christ. We have received, Lord, the abundance of grace, of unmerited favor, and the gift of righteousness. So we take our place with you, resting in the victory that you have provided, resting in fullness of joy, fullness of peace, fullness of liberty, fullness of victory. And we are manifestors of heaven on earth. Heaven is on the inside of us, and heaven manifests through us. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for causing us to see the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. Cause us to see, cause us to know what we have, who we are in Christ Jesus, what we can do. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. King Jesus, we love you. King Jesus, we honor you in this place. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Thank you for quenching the spiritual thirst of your people. You said, he that cometh unto me shall never thirst, but he shall have in him a well springing up into everlasting life. Thank you for that well on the inside. And thank you for those rivers that flow out of us. They flow to us first, in us and through us. We receive, Lord. We receive your presence. We receive the fullness of joy, the fullness of peace, the fullness of love. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, we thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Make it personal. Oh. Make it personal. Make it personal to each person. Each one knowing you, Lord. Each one having an encounter with you. Oh, you're such a good shepherd. Such a wonderful Savior. Savior. You save us. You save us. You save us. You save us. You save us in every situation. You are the Savior that saves. Hallelujah. If you've got a situation, it doesn't matter. He's still the Savior. And he's still in the business of saving. He's still in the business of saving. He's still in the business of meeting you right in the middle of your situation and saving you right in the middle of it. Thank you, Jesus. We receive the fullness of salvation tonight. All the benefits and blessings that have been bestowed and conferred upon us through the knowledge of him, the full, the personal, the precise, the correct knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, our Lord. whereby are given unto us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these you might become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Lord, we thank you. We're full of peace. Fullness of peace. Fullness of peace in your presence. You are the Prince of Peace. Thank you for your peace, Lord. Enveloping. Yeah, his peace just envelops us. His peace is part of the defense of God, the protection of God around us. It's a shield that covers you. It's a shield that shields your heart and your mind. The enemy can't get to your heart. The enemy can't get to your mind. Why? Because the peace of God is a shield. It's a covering. It's a canopy of the glory. Canopy of your glory, Father. We receive the canopy of your peace and your glory and your presence. Oh. Oh. So wonderful. So wonderful. Thank you, Lord. Just roll it over on him. Roll it over on him. Whatever you've been carrying, give it to the Master. And then take his peace. Jesus. There's an activation going on right now. There's an activation of the Spirit of seeing and knowing. He's turning it up right now. Dreams and visions are the language of the Holy Ghost. And in His presence, He wants you to see. He wants to show you some things. Part of prayer is calling to me, and I'll answer you and I'll show you. That's visual. Show you. Ephesians 2:6 says, and has raised us up together, made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Why did he seat us there? That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. When you go to church, you're going to the show. God's going to put on a show. God wants to show you the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us. We need to see it. Show us, Lord. Open our eyes. Lord, bring that angel of wisdom and revelation. Ephesians 1 says the spirit of wisdom and revelation. It's a spirit sent from God whose purpose is to show you what he has for you, to show you what God has done for you. We receive those angels of revelation, Lord. We yield to the influence of that angelic help, causing us to see realms and mysteries in your word that have been hidden from ages and from generations, but are now being revealed to the church through your holy apostles and prophets. Thank you, Father. We yield to your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. He's doing a miracle in minds right now. He's changing the way some of you have been thinking. And it's literally an impartation of the mind of Christ so that you think the way he thinks, so that you can get in unity in your soul, in your mind, with what heaven is doing. His word says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, and my ways than your ways. But you see, when you start getting your mind unified with his mind, the mind of Christ, I heard that he's changing like pathways. I guess they're called neuropathways. Or engrams. Your mind is like a muscle. It builds ways that you think, and then those become just patterns of how you think. But God is doing a miracle, and I would reach out and take this. I wouldn't wonder about it. I'd take it, because I want to think more like heaven does. Because Everything from heaven passes into your spirit, but it has to come through your mind. That's why he says you'll prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. So if you want to participate in receiving this, just put your hand on your mind and say, Lord Jesus, I receive your way of thinking. I receive the mind of Christ, your neuropathways, thinking higher, thinking from the spirit of faith, thinking from the spirit of wisdom and revelation. My mind is yours tonight. I give you lordship in my mind. And I take my post to take every thought obedient to Christ and captive to Christ in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Well, I've never prayed that, but I don't have to. You know, I believe that there's a lot of things in the Word maybe we haven't prayed before. It doesn't mean they're not there, just maybe we haven't seen them. But you know what? The Holy Spirit knows how we need to pray to access the things He's wanting to release in this hour. Amen? I thank God for everything He has released, but I do believe there are mysteries hidden in the Word of God that He is endeavoring to release to those that would be open to His Spirit and His Word. They're never going to violate the written Word of God, obviously, and they're never going to violate the Spirit of the Word, because the Spirit and the Word always agree. Amen? But I believe He's doing a miracle in your mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'll tell you, that's a great miracle, because if your mind receive with meekness the engrafted word that is able to save your souls. Bless God, we got our spirit born again the day we made Jesus our Lord, but it's a process of walking out the salvation of our souls. And some people would say when they have an evangelistic crusade, well, we got 50 souls saved. Well, no, that's not really technically totally accurate. You got 50 spirits saved, but there is a process of mind renewal from the Word of God. And the Bible actually says, and be not conformed, you can be seated, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing. And that word transformed is what happened to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. He became glorified. And I believe God wants to glorify His kids in this last hours we have on planet Earth. However much time it is, however much time we're here, He wants us to have maximum impact. And a big part of that is going to be in you continually being transformed in your mind. And it's not a one-time process, because a lot of us have been in this walk a long time. But faith doesn't come by having heard. It only comes by hearing and hearing. Continuous present tense. Amen? Faith comes by hearing and hearing. And so we've got to continue. Peter said, as long as I'm in this tent, as long as I'm in my body, I'm going to stir you up. How? How am I going to stir you up? You know, when something sits there a long time on the stove and it's not stirred up, it can start to burn. And burnt food doesn't taste very good. But when it gets stirred up, amen, it releases all the flavor and it preserves the food that's on the bottom from being burned. Amen? And he says, I want to stir you up, or I want to release the good things of the kingdom through you. How do I get stirred up? By being put in remembrance of the truths that he's already released in the word. Because you know what? Yesterday's faith is yesterday's faith. Yesterday's manna doesn't work for today. You can't save up your faith. Amen? You can develop your faith. You can exercise your faith and make it stronger. But we need a continuous flow of Holy Spirit. We need a continuous flow of the Word of God in our life, helping us and bringing that freshness and that newness. Because Jesus said, behold,
I make some things new. All things new. I make all things new. Amen. That means it never gets old serving God. But there's a newness. Just like Christmas morning. Over and over and over. Amen. When you're serving Jesus, it's just full of joy. It's just glorious serving Him. Amen. Well, if our audio video team could turn the lights on. I know you're there. I see you, a faint outline. Glory to God. There you are. Praise the Lord. I'll let your eyes adjust for a second. Glory to God. Did you all enjoy that time in His presence? Well, His presence isn't leaving just because we're shifting gears a bit. Holy Spirit's still here. He's in each one of us. Amen? And I want to check real quickly. Do we have any first-time visitors? If this is your first time at Oasis Church, we just want to honor you and welcome you. If it is, would you put your hand up for just a second so we can welcome you tonight? Praise the Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give them a hand. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We are thrilled when God sends new people into this church. God put us here to help people, to teach you the Word of God, teach you about the ministry of the Holy Spirit in your life, because the Holy Spirit's come to show us the things that are freely given to us of God. And so the devil is scared to death that you would find out about the ministry of Holy Spirit in your life, because as soon as you find out about the ministry of the Holy Spirit, he's going to take the Word of God and unveil it, uncover it. It's kind of like a, you know, maybe a car show where they've got an awesome new body style of a car that, you know, maybe it's a 2014 Corvette. When they're going to unveil it, they have it covered in a veil, and you're just kind of seeing an outline. You're like, something really cool is there. And then they pull the veil off, and you see it, and you're like, whoa, nice car, right? Amen? Well, that's what Holy Spirit does. He knows all these truths. He knows what you can get, and he gives you what you can get, right? There's some things that if he pulled the veil off, it might fry your brain. So it's line upon line, precept upon precept. He works, he knows what we can take and how much. Amen. Hallelujah. So anyway, our ushers have a visitor packet for you. And in that visitor packet is a place for you to fill out little information so we could know about you and your visit. Also a place for prayer requests, and we'll receive an offering in just a minute. And if you would drop that in there, and if there's any prayer requests, we'll get that to our intercessors and make sure they have a chance to pray over your situation. So many good testimonies coming in this week. It's just been an amazing week of breakthrough for people. Yes. Amen? Yes. One testimony of stage 4 terminal. How many of you know there's no such thing as terminal cancer in the kingdom of God? I don't care what stage. Jesus has got a higher stage. Stage 4 terminal cancer, completely healed. Completely healed. Doctor verified. Hallelujah. Even after this, one of the top specialists in the country sat down and said, I'm sorry, there's nothing we can do. That's when Jesus says, yeah, there's something I can do about it. Amen? Glory to God. Testimonies of people getting great new jobs. Testimonies Sunday morning, a bunch of people got healed instantly of different things. To God be all the glory for that. I am so thankful for his presence, and I'm so thankful that in his presence is the ministry of Jesus released. You know that? When the presence of Jesus comes into the place, the same ministry of Jesus happens and is available that happened when he walked the earth. It's the same presence of God. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, we don't even have any announcements tonight. Can you believe it? No announcements. But I hope, I will say this. So I'm going to add one announcement. If you didn't make it to Revive Groups Sunday night, you have got to listen to the video we covered. You can go on YouTube. It's by Dan Moeller. It's called Becoming Love. And I'm telling you, it is one of the best messages I've heard in my life. Did anybody listen to it? You were there at the Revive Groups. Were you blessed by it? Yes. Oh, it was so good. So good. So powerful. And that's what we want to do. That's what we want to do, is become love in every avenue of our life. Because that's what Jesus walked in. And love never fails. Amen? Glory to God. If you want to sow tonight, if you'll lift your hand, want to give an offering, a love gift or a tithe or an offering, if you'll lift your hand up, our ushers will get you an offering envelope. If you're making a check, if you'll make it out to Oasis Church, I want to read a verse. This verse is such a powerful truth about biblical prosperity. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9. It says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich." Part of the grace of God for your life and mine is for us to become rich. Now, somebody might say, what is that, the prosperity gospel? No, it's the only gospel. It's part and parcel of the gospel. I don't preach a separate gospel, but part of the gospel is that God wants to give you an abundant supply, and it's the grace of God. It's supernatural empowerment. And just like all the other types of grace of God, you've got to know about it, which is one of the reasons the Lord's quickened me to teach and to talk about the grace of God, to teach and talk about the manifold grace of God. As good stewards of the manifold grace of God. What's manifold? It's many faceted. You know, what makes diamonds beautiful is not just their color or their clarity, but it's their cut. The best diamonds, I used to work at B.C. Clark for just a few months when we first few months we moved to Oklahoma City, and they had these diamonds called Lazar Kaplan diamonds. And they had this special cutting process where they took these diamonds and they were perfectly cut, I believe by a laser, so that they had ultimate refraction. And the lady said, amen. But what made these diamonds, and they would just sparkle like crazy. You could put one of these Lazar Kaplan diamonds next to a diamond that had the same color, clarity, and carat weight. Identical in every other way, but because these Lazar Kaplan diamonds were cut so perfectly, they would shine that much more and sparkle that much more. And they were more expensive by substantial amounts because of that. They were very prestigious diamonds, right? And anyway, the grace of God is like that. The grace of God is manifold grace, multifaceted grace. And so the first grace we receive is the grace to be born again. When we call upon Jesus, make him the Lord of our life, what happens? We tap into the grace, for by grace, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, one of my first memory verses, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So maybe you've heard about the grace to get born again, that he became sin for us, that we might call upon him and become the righteousness of God in him. And so you've tapped into that facet of the grace of God. And because of that, you now have a relationship with God. You now are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And you can have fellowship with God because you become a new creation, a new species of being, one that never existed before. You become this new creation because you've tapped into that facet of grace. And maybe you walked a little farther and you heard another facet of the grace of God was the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that you could be filled with power from on high, divine supernatural ability by receiving the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And at some point, if you receive that grace, you began to speak in a supernatural prayer language that you never knew before. What is that prayer language about? Speaking mysteries and secrets unto God. Amen? That builds you up in your most holy faith when you pray in the Holy Spirit, edifies you, charges you spiritually as you speak in an unknown tongue. And you know, the Apostle Paul said this, for I will pray in the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding. Now, when I got born again, I got saved in a denomination that taught me initially that you could only speak in tongues when the Spirit came upon you, so to speak. In other words, when you felt the urge to speak, then you could speak in tongues. And I subscribed to that for a little while, And I'm not holding that against them. At least they teach people to get filled with the Holy Ghost. That's a good start. Amen? But I didn't understand that the very reason I need to speak in other tongues is I don't feel anointed. That's the very time that I need the most to be filled with the Spirit and speak in other tongues and be filled with God is when I feel the least anointed. And when the Holy Spirit comes, he doesn't come just when you feel him. The Bible says in John 14 or 16, somewhere in there, you can look it up, that when he comes, he will come and make his abode with you forever. And so the Holy Spirit comes and he's there and you say, well, I can't just turn him on and off like a light switch. Well, no, he's always on, waiting for you to speak. And all that it takes to step out and speak in an unknown tongue is faith. Faith that he'll give you the utterance. And because it's, and see, so when you speak in an unknown tongue, you actually are doing a faith workout. You're getting filled with the Spirit and you're doing a faith workout. And you could be very dry starting when you're praying in tongues. But the longer you pray in tongues, it's like a glass getting filled up, more and more and more. And pretty soon you may have started dry, but after a while, you're going to hit a gusher. Yeah. Amen? So I want to encourage you because, what does something need to be true or scriptural? What do you got to have? Faith. Scriptures. Faith from the scriptures, but scriptures. For something to be scriptural, you got to have scriptures. That's really, really simple. It's oversimplification, but it is true. So if you have a scriptural promise or teaching, so Paul said, and you can look it up in 1 Corinthians 14, he said, I will, that means he was saying, at my will, I can pray in other tongues and I can sing in other tongues. I can pray in English, I can sing in English, amen? And so that's a blessing. That's part of the grace of God, getting filled with the Holy Ghost, getting born again. Maybe you've tapped into the grace of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation. There's grace as you pray. And I've done it ever since I got taught about it back in 1992 or 3, whenever it was. I've made it a regular practice to pray for the Spirit of wisdom and revelation. I encourage you to do the same. It's in Ephesians 1 and then Ephesians 3. Those two prayers, I would put that in part of your daily prayer regimen. Because as you pray for the Spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe. That's a powerful prayer to pray for you because you're praying for your spiritual eyes to be flooded with light, that you might see, that you might know the things that are freely given to you of God. Amen? And then over in Ephesians 3, another Spirit-inspired prayer, that you would be strengthened with might in your inner man, that Christ, the anointed Jesus and his anointing, might dwell in your heart by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in what? Love. We've been talking about love. Rooted and grounded in love. You want the love of God to develop in your life? Start praying Ephesians 3. Lord, I want to be rooted and grounded in love. I want to be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the length, the breadth, the depth, the height, to know the love of the anointed Jesus and his anointing, which passes knowledge, that I might be filled with all the fullness of God. I like the Amplified. That I might be diffused throughout my being with the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly filled and flooded with God himself. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. And I like that. Amen. Holy filled and flooded with God himself. Isn't that awesome? Holy filled. And then not just filled, flooded. Holy filled means you're wholly filled. You're complete. You can't hold anymore. Flooded means you just overflowed. And what happens when you overflow? Somebody else gets touched. So I want overflow. How about you? I'm claiming overflow. Overflow. But what else? What other types of grace are there? Praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. This is the word you're getting tonight. This is another type of the grace of God. And I think for some reason, for some Christians, the devil has put blinders on them to this grace. But I'm telling you, God's trying to take blinders off, and to help you see and understand that this is just a valid of grace as the grace that heals you, the grace that empowers you to do whatever you do in the kingdom. Amen. The grace that that gets you born again, that, all the different types of grace, this is another type of the grace of God. And Jesus suffered specifically for you and I to get this grace. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. And some people said, well, that means Jesus became poor spiritually. No, Jesus didn't become poor spiritually. I'm sorry, he walked on the water. I'm sorry, he translated the boat full of the disciples to the other side. I'm sorry, he raised Lazarus 4 days dead. And if he wouldn't have said, Lazarus, come forth, the whole graveyard would have emptied. Okay? Jesus was not poor spiritually. Not talking about spiritually here. Talking about the grace of God. There is a grace of God to give you an abundant supply. But like all grace, you got to find out about it. You got to find out what belongs to you in Christ Jesus. This is part of the grace of God. Amen. And I would say this is one of the primary areas the enemy has hindered the body of Christ from fulfilling the Great Commission. Because if the enemy could hold back the finances, most of the vision that God wants to accomplish, think about if we had a TV ministry that went all over the world. And let's say we could broadcast to the whole world on a TV station that people could get in their language where they're at. Can you imagine how many more people we could reach? A lot of people would hear the gospel and be taught the word of God. But what would that take to do that? That would take some money, wouldn't it? It'd take quite a bit of money. Amen. And, you know, if God's called you to do certain things, he will provide those things. Amen. But part of the way he does that is the body gets a hold that there is a grace that God doesn't just want to bless. Now, he wants to bless you too, okay? It's not either or with God. It's not he can bless you or he can fulfill the Great Commission. He's a rich God. He's a rich God, okay? He speaks and planets are formed. Amen? And you can be a great blessing and still have enough left over that you are greatly blessed. Amen. That's the kingdom, because he's a rich God. He's a too much God. Amen? Yes. He says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes, he didn't become poor for him. He became poor for us. Amen? Yes. He became poor for us. I mean, think about it. Jesus was with the Father before he came to earth. And I've read about heaven. Have you? It's beyond opulent. It's beyond words. It's described in Revelation, but your brain just goes tilt when you read about, you know, a single oyster or pearl. That how big was that oyster to make that pearl for the single gate? That's how big? I mean, we're talking amazing stuff that kind of makes your brain go tilt. How wealthy Jesus was there in heaven. But when he came to earth, there wasn't even room for him in the end. And he was born in a manger. Amen? But prosperity came upon him. But when did he become poor? I believe part of that curse of poverty, and poverty is a curse. Poverty is a curse. We love the poor. We hate poverty. We love the poor. We want to help the poor. We hate poverty. You should hate sin. You should hate sickness, and you should hate poverty, because in God's original creation, none of them existed. You could not go to the Garden of Eden and find any poverty. You could not find. Adam and Eve weren't even working. They were simply stewarding or caring for this opulent place that God had this. And before God ever made Adam and Eve, he put this garden there that was beyond anything they could ever ask or think. It was such a beautiful, wealthy place. In Genesis 2, it identifies the rivers and the gold and the onyx, and it said the gold of that place is good. You know why gold keeps its value? God said it's good. That's why gold holds its value. And so God didn't create all the good things, on planet Earth for the world to have them. I said God didn't create the cattle on 1,000 hills for the world and for the devil. Well, Pastor, we're not supposed to love the things in the world. No, we're not supposed to love them, but he said we could enjoy them. Charge them that are rich in this world. That's you and me. We're rich. Say, I'm rich.
I'm rich.
I'm rich. Amen. You should make that your confession. I'm rich. Glory to God. What does rich mean? Abundantly supplied for. 1 Timothy 6:17, if you need the reference. Charge them that are rich in this world, that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. Why? Because he gives us richly all things to enjoy. Did you see that? When you keep your heart and your mind and you keep humble, God can give you richly all things, even for you to enjoy and to be blessed to be a blessing. Amen? He delights in blessing his kids. He just wants to make sure that you don't get your eyes on the blessing and keep your eyes on the bless or. Amen. Glory to God. And so he is not against you being wealthy, but wealth, the grace to become wealthy, is there's a process of qualifying. Amen. And Jesus first, others second, yourself last. Joy. Jesus first, others second, yourself last. See, that's part of the priority of not becoming selfish and just going after things. Amen? Amen? God owns everything. I own nothing. That's another part of being wealthy God's way. You got to understand you don't own a thing. Yeah, but it says my name on the deed. Yeah, but who made that dirt? Who put that planet in orbit around the sun? It wasn't you or me. It was him. The Bible says in Psalms 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. When you start getting the idea that you are a steward and a steward alone, you own nothing, God owns everything, then it's never a problem when Holy Spirit says, I want you to do this for them or him or her, or I want you to give this in the offering, or I want you to send this missionary, or I want to do whatever it is that he says to you. Whenever he does that, then you're like, yes, Lord, because I don't own that anyway. That belongs to you. And knowing this, that anything he would speak to you about sowing, anything, is because he's got something better he's going to get to you. He never takes, he is not a taker. And you cannot outgive God. Amen? Does that mean you just write a check for everything you own? No, it doesn't mean that. You're led and you've got guidelines in the word, tithes and offerings. But, you know, Holy Spirit sometimes will prompt you to do something. For instance, I got a call on Monday. And it was a church member that was kind of freaked out. And they were freaked out because Sunday, Holy Spirit told them to sow $300. And they had never sown $300 before. And they obeyed. Wonder what would happen. Wonder what. See, I don't want to live my life knowing God spoke me to do something and I didn't obey. What would have happened if I would have obeyed? I can't live with that. I'm sorry. I just can't. I'm going to obey. Because he's a big God and he can do a whole lot of stuff. So anyway, they gave the $300 seed. And I get a call. We're driving with the kids to Dry Gulch. Kids are at Dry Gulch and the youth are at Branson, and they're all having a blast, and I'm a little bit jealous that I'm not there with them. Just confessing that sin because I know they're having a blast. But I got a call, and the guy on the phone's like, I have $8,000 in my account that somebody deposited in my account 24 hours after I obeyed God, and so this $300 seed, Holy Spirit told me to sow. So they sowed $300 and got a 30-fold return, basically. Almost at the, it was like a 28, 29-fold. We're not talking percent. We're talking fold return in less than 24 hours. Or right around 24 hours, I should say. That's a pretty good return. Now, would that have happened if they wouldn't obey God? I can't tell you. I kind of doubt it. But it did happen. And I got the call, and they were very excited. And a little bit overwhelmed, like, what do I do with all this money? I said, whatever you're faithful over, God will whatever level of wealth you have, if you're faithful over it, you're in line for more. That's the whole key in the kingdom of God. Whatever you're faithful over, God will keep expanding the blessing on your life. And that's why it says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty, what's the next word? Might. There's a lot of mites in there. Leroy Thompson taught me this, and I've never forgot it. He said, you know what might means? It means might and might not. Now, none of that has to do with God. God's not in charge of the might and might not. God has made it available. But the might has to do with the fact that it's what we do with the grace. Jesus paid for you to be saved, healed, delivered, baptized in the Holy Ghost, that you might be filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. But you have to say, I see that blessing. It's for me today, right now, and I want that blessing, and I'm going to lay hold of it. Now, I believe in lifting my hands in worship, but when I go to the dinner table to eat, I don't lift my hands up to eat. I reach out on the table, and I take a hold of what it is that I want to eat, right? And I'm pretty good at it. Some of you look like you're pretty good, too. So anyway, praise the Lord. Just a little humor. Somebody said very little. Okay. So you have to reach out and take hold of what he's given you. It's not a struggle because he said the kingdom of God is at hand. All the blessings are this close. If you'd have put your hands out this close, Jesus said the kingdom of God is right here and right now. And part of that kingdom is abundance and wealth. And let me tell you what happens when you get jacked into the supply of the kingdom of God. Guess what happens? The spirit of fear leaves your life. That's what happens. Because now it's not my job, it's not my ability, it's not my resources. The pressure comes off men, the pressure comes off your shoulders to make it happen. Doesn't mean you don't set your hand to do something. Doesn't mean you're not diligent in what you do. Just means that at the end of the day, the blessing of the Lord is what makes rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. One translation says, toil adds nothing to it. God's not called you to toil. God's called you to walk in his yoke and his grace, which is light and easy, and he wants you to have peace. This is part of the full package of peace that comes in our salvation. There's abundant supply. To be rich means to have an abundant supply. I like 2 Corinthians 9. We'll finish over there. We'll receive the offering. We're actually going to receive the offering. But I'm talking about the grace of God. And this wasn't my notes, but it could still benefit you if you get a hold of it. 2 Corinthians 9, 8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. Do we have that in the Amplified? I believe it says, and God is able to grant you a surplus of prosperity. Is that what it says? Praise the Lord. If we have it in the, oh, you've got it in the Amplified. Thank you, hon. And God is able to make all grace, every favor and earthly blessing come to you in abundance. This is the rich he's talking about. And God is able to make all grace, every favor and earthly blessing come to you in abundance, so that you may always and under all circumstances and whatever the need be self-sufficient, possessing enough to require no aid or support, and furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. Hallelujah. That means you could sow into an abundance of ministries, and at the end of the day, you still have way too much for you. Glory to God, for you to be abundantly blessed. That's our Father. He's a too much God. And I'm telling you, this is a valid grace. It's a grace you must qualify for, because some people would be destroyed if they had too much. And fathers, If that was the case, if you were going to get enough money, if God was going to bring enough money into your life, that would cause you to become unfaithful and leave God and go off into sin, or if that's the case, you need to get your heart right with God anyway. Amen. You need to know who you are at the core, no matter how much money you have. And some people say the money is the root of all evil. No, it's not. The love of money is the root of all evil. You take a wicked person, give them a lot of money, and they will multiply wickedness. You give a righteous man a lot of money, and a righteous man or woman will cause a whole lot of good to come to pass. Amen? A righteous person will use that wealth to build the kingdom of God and be blessed in the process. Amen? And so money has no spirits, neither good nor evil. Money just takes on the spirit of the possessor. And so if you love God, amen? In one scripture, money is called filthy lucre. In another scripture, money is called a sweet-smelling savor and sacrifice, acceptable, well-pleasing unto God. What's the difference? It's who has it, who uses it, and what it's used for. And I'm telling you, when you decide you're going to use the wealth God gives you, that you're not an owner, you're a steward, and because you're a steward, Holy Spirit, you have privileges to my checkbook. I'm telling you how to be rich. I'm really giving you keys that if you get this in your heart and the core of your being and you live this out, God will make you rich. Now, did I say all of you are going to be multimillionaires? I didn't say that, but I said the biblical definition here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 8. And I would read that. I'd meditate on it. God can get it to you if he can get it through you. And he's looking. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect towards him. And I would tell him, look no further, Lord. Here I am. Don't tire your eyes. Right here I am, Lord. Right here. Lay it on me. And I'm going to use it to bless the kingdom of God. I would tell him that. Lord, don't tire your eyes out looking all over. Right here. Praise the Lord. Count me in. Amen. Glory to God. He's a good God. I'm telling you, he's going to make people rich. Abundantly supplied for. Amen. And as you are faithful over whatever level you have, faith, you know, here's the thing, and I'll wrap it up with this. We have checkbook privileges with Jesus. We have a joint account, heirs of God and joint heirs. That's called joint checking with Jesus. His account, you have rights and privileges to write a check and sign his name and get what's in the account. You do. You have joint checking with Jesus. So when he wants part of his money, it shouldn't be any big deal. Because it's his money anyway, isn't it? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, we're going to go ahead and receive the offering. But I want to encourage you, tap into all the manifold grace of God, including the grace that will make you rich and abundantly supplied for so you can be blessed to be a blessing. Amen? Let's pray over our offerings. Father, we thank you tonight for the grace of God. We thank you that Jesus took the crown of thorns on his brow so that we wouldn't have to toil and sweat to try and barely make ends meet. Instead, you've released an abundance of grace, a gift of righteousness, and the anointing of prosperity, which is the power to get wealth. Father, you said, but you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he that gives thee the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto thy fathers as it is this day. Lord, you are the one that anoints us, gives us ideas, witty inventions, strength to carry them out, and the spirit of wisdom and revelation to see and know things. Yes, forerunners. There's a spirit of the forerunner that he's releasing right now in business, I believe, for you to see what's going to be the next trend, what's going to be the next idea that's going to bring wealth. Lord, we just I'm reaching out and take a hold of that. I take a hold of that, Lord, that spirit of the forerunner to see ahead the things that are coming in different realms, because ideas can equal tremendous wealth. So we, Lord, we thank you for causing us to see ahead by your spirit where to invest, ideas, witty inventions, all these things, Lord. I thank you. We receive it. We lay hold of it now. It's our inheritance. Thank you, Lord. We seize it because it's ours. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for releasing these ideas. Thank you, Lord. I'm just reminded, ushers, let's go ahead and receive the offering. I'm reminded of a person who has had a vision of heaven or was transported to heaven, something to that effect. And there was this great building or hall with these doors, and it had these two giant angels guarding it. And in it were all these inventions and secrets that would come on the earth in time, right? That were in heaven. But thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Part of biblical prosperity, I believe, is you see into heaven. You can see into heaven the things that are coming, and God can use you to release those things. And sometimes there's great wealth tied to them. Now, that we may not do that, and that's okay, but some of us may tap into that, and it may be a great blessing to you. Amen? Yes. And to the kingdom of God. When it comes in, don't forget Jesus. Yes, honey. Praise God. Come up here and share that, Haley. Hallelujah.
She did it myself. Before Pastor James even began to speak tonight, I saw white wicker baskets, like kind of like a small, maybe a linen basket where you would, you know, throw your clothes into, something like that. White wicker baskets with small piece of linen draped over it. It was very nicely done, tied at the front, dropping. They're about this big and this wide. Dropping all over the sanctuary. You've been walking through them, Pastor, all night long. There are enough for every person in the room, because I asked the Lord, and he said, there's enough for every person in here. What is in the basket? I saw steering wheel covers. That's a car. Just let me help you out. I saw steering wheel covers. I saw miniature homes. Woo! I saw huge dollars. The dollars rained down before the baskets came.
Hallelujah.
And many more things that I don't fully understand, but they're here, and I believe that you can come up and partake of them right now. So I'm going to get mine. But there's enough for every individual. It's not per family.
Before you leave. Yes.
Take it home with you. It is yours. It is yours. One for everyone.
Hallelujah. Get your stuff. Get your stuff. Glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Now, somebody might say, well, that's a little bit weird. Yeah, but when you give $300 and get $8,000 the next day, I'm good with weird. I'm okay with weird. Are you okay with weird? I mean, I haven't read it, but Craig Groeschel's got a book called Weird, because normal isn't working. I like the title. I don't want normal finances. I want weird in a good way, because we tapped into heaven's resources. Glory to God. I love it when the Holy Ghost confirms things, because I didn't have any of these plans, but Jesus did. Amen? Well, let's stand on our feet. Glory to God. You may have to... Ooh, I'm just reminded of one more verse. He daily loads us with benefits. Hallelujah. New cars, houses. Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you are daily loading us with benefits. So we're taking out of the treasury of the kingdom of God the load of benefits that you have for each one of us, Lord. We receive it. We thank you. We believe it. Lord, tell him you believe it. I believe it, Lord. We believe it. We believe. Now, listen to me. The Bible says, believe in the Lord your God and you'll be established. Believe his prophets and so shall you prosper. Haley just gave a prophetic word about what heaven was releasing. You believe it? Watch yourself prosper. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Woo. Ha. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, I would spend some extra time when you get home rejoicing. Glory to God. Good things are manifesting. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Daddy. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, hallelujah. I'm ready for testimonies. You can email me the testimonies. We need to give these testimonies, more and more testimonies to come. Amen. Will you be super blessed as you go? Take your load of benefits and blessing with you. God bless you.
So helpless.